Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Out of Breath, written by Anna Snoekstra and read by Anna Downs.
For the magnificent Phoebe Baker. Part 1. Chapter 1. Sydney, September 2018. Sydney looks nothing like the places where Jo grew up. The first few years of her life, in the village of St. Ives, shone in pastels. Mint green and warm cream and the iced aquamarine of the bay. Then Chesterfield, the colours washed out and muddied. London could be captured in monochrome. Even the water of the Thames looked more grey than blue for most of the year. There's something about the quality of light in Australia that's different to anywhere else. Jo can't place why exactly, but it makes colours more saturated. The bus pulls in for a stop, and Jo is crammed further into the window as more passengers get on. It's a hot day, the air on board soupy with body heat. Sweat itches her face and her T-shirt sticks to her back. A woman with a baby presses up next to her. Jo grins at the infant, who hides its eyes under the edge of the carrier. They turn a corner, and this is it. This is the reason Jo loves catching the bus, even though it stinks of BO. She watches Sydney Harbour stretch out, postcard perfect, all silvers and blues and stark whites. The baby peeks around the carrier again, smiling this time. She pulls a face at it, and it giggles, and everything feels so right. She's finished a long shift at the cafe, and now she's on her way to her second job, and she's exhausted, but still, she is filled up. She's going to make this life work. This is going to be her place, her home, for keeps. Jo presses the stop button and weaves her way through elbows and backpacks, steps out onto the street right in front of the pub where she hosts her trivia nights. Jo sits on a stool at the edge of the bar, checking the trivia results from the first round. She goes down the list with her red pen, marking ticks or crosses next to each line and tallying the results. Beer? The bartender asks her over the taps. Just a soda water. Of course. She likes pubs in Australia much more than the ones back home. In England, the pubs felt closer, darker. They were always too warm with their cranking heaters and open fireplaces. The pubs here have high ceilings, cement floors. They keep the doors open because the air outside is balmy and the sun doesn't set until 8 p.m. The bartender gives her the soda water, a wedge of lime straddling the rim of the glass. Cheers. Jo holds the papers under her arm and slides off the stool. She likes to see the different groups who turn up to her trivia nights. She speculates at what binds each team. Sitting by the window is a couple who come every week. They usually score last, since they're only two compared to the teams of six or seven, but it doesn't seem to bother them. They put their heads together, whisper answers to one another, laugh private laughs. She gives them their sheet and they thank her. There's another regular group who sits at the long table in the centre of the room. Work colleagues, Jo assumes. Their team name is Jane's Got the Number, and every time she reads it out, they laugh. We're winning, right? One of the guys asks as she approaches. His T-shirt is a dark red, bringing out the pink in his nose, the freckles on his hands. It had taken Jo a while to get used to people's skin in Australia. Even for the average person, it is more weathered. It tells more of a story. It's the sun, bringing everything to the surface. You'll see, she says. They are, by a mile. She hands them their sheet and they crowd over it. All except one woman who doesn't check to see how they scored. She's wearing bright lipstick and seems uncomfortable. Her shoulders are stiff. Jo didn't see her here last week. There's often someone like this in a group, someone who knew none of the answers and felt more and more like an idiot as the game progressed. Round by round, Jo would see their eyes glaze over as their focus turned inward. Now she smiles at the woman over the heads of the others. The woman seems surprised and smiles back in a pained sort of way. Jo passes out the rest of the sheets. Up close, she can see the group near the door are related, the same green eyes, some lined with wrinkles, smile at her as she drops the sheet. The table in the corner all have beards. The group in their early 20s on the far wall have tattoos that are so new they look like they've been drawn on their smooth forearms and thighs with felt-tip markers. She has one sheet left in her hands. It's for Eric's team, but their seats are empty. Their dinner plates haven't been cleared yet, massacres of tomato sauce on porcelain under scrunched-up napkins. She leaves their sheet in the centre of the table, goes to find them outside. The dimming evening air is cool enough to wake her up a little. She stopped taking her sleeping pills a few weeks ago and her insomnia is back. It's not as torturous this time. She used to lay awake with her uncertainty spinning the room. Now, lying next to Eric, she thinks about their future. It grounds her. His group is sitting at a wooden table in the beer garden, smoking. Ashwan, Alice, Brianna, and Eric. They fit together, too, in a way that isn't as easy to identify. It's something in the confidence of their laughs, the way they gesticulate with their cigarettes, the concavity of their shoulders from too long hunching over academic journals. On their first date, Eric had first told her that his PhD was on the commodity culture of cult television. She thought he was joking. He'd been offended when she'd laughed. "You need to put rice on it," Eric is saying to Ashwan, who shares his office space at the university. "Nah, don't do that. It gets under your keyboard. Then every time you hit a key, it crunches. It's awful."
"Didn't you use quinoa or something that time?"
"Nah, bulgur wheat. Stupid.
I already dried it anyway and it's working."
Eric puts an arm around Joe as she slots in next to him.
"How'd you dry it?"
"Just with a fucking towel."
They laugh at that. Then Brianna takes the sheet from Joe, but doesn't bother checking how they did. Brianna is her only real friend here in Sydney. When Joe realised she wasn't going to make rent just from her trivia nights, Brianna got her a job at the cafe where she works. Brianna dropped out of her arts PhD in her first year, and now she's putting herself through law school making coffee.
"Eric, can you please convince Joe not to go to Broome? She has no clue what she's in for."
Joe laughs. It's endearing how close anger and kindness are for Brianna.
"I can't convince her to do anything she doesn't want to do."
That's not true. And anyway, Jo no longer has any intention of going to Broome. She can't. Alice blows out her smoke, smiles.
"I went on a road trip around there, I don't know, 6 years ago? With Lauren, when we first started going out."
"That's a way to break the ice," Eric says.
He holds his cigarette out, away from the group. Its smoke dissolves into the greying sky. There is an elegance to the bend of his wrist.
"What was it like?" Joe asks.
"So beautiful."
Joe knows that. She's Googled it. Red dirt, huge blue skies. It didn't look like anywhere she'd been before.
"Yeah, but it's isolated, right?"
Brianna says.
"And there's some absolute creeps out there."
Alice thinks about it, fiddles with her bottom lip, running a finger along it like she's remembering a kiss.
"So we were driving around in a four-wheel drive, you know, camping along the way. It was always fine, really nice. But this one night, we were at a campground and there wasn't anyone else. It was kind of cool, like we were the only people in the world. The sky was so big, huge, like you wouldn't believe. But then this guy showed up in his car. People are usually so friendly out there, but he, I don't know, the energy just changed. He didn't come say hi or anything. He stayed in his car, parked far away in the shadows of a tree. All night he didn't come out, just sat in his car. We suddenly felt so aware of ourselves, you know, two women by ourselves. We hadn't felt that before then. We left as soon as it got light."
"Creepy," Brianna says.
Alice raises her eyebrows.
"It was probably nothing."
"I'd guess he was hiding out from the cops or something."
Brianna holds Joe's eye, face serious.
"That's why people go out there, you know, to disappear."
She grins at Eric.
"You guys should get married. A visa wedding would be so much fun. Then she wouldn't have to go."
Joe tries to feel Eric's reaction next to her. Did he stiffen? Did he pull away at all? They're meant to be talking about this later tonight.
It could just be a party,
Brianna insists. Are you proposing to my girlfriend for me?
She's awesome. Why wouldn't you want to?
I'm right here, Joe says.
Why are you going so far out? Ashwan asks.
I don't want to go so far. I don't want to go at all. You don't need to convince me. She looks pointedly at Brianna, then back to Ashwan. It was the only place that agreed to take me. A cultural exchange, they call it, but she knows it's about cheap labour. Still, 88 days wasn't that long. 88 days and she'd come back and her life would return to normal. Or at least, that was what the plan had been. When she'd first started applying, she'd been excited. A new adventure, a whole new experience. She'd see the other side of Australia. The Australia with farmers and kangaroos, not skyscrapers and arseholes in suits. But everything is different now.
Isn't there some place you can do it that's a bit closer? I mean, the Kimberley is, what, 2 flights away? 8 hours?
Ashwan asks. The ones that were closer were mostly hostels. If you stay there, they find you work, apparently. But I don't want to stay in a hostel for 3 months with a bunch of English people. Joe isn't very patriotic, Eric says, his arms still around her, fingers fiddling with the ends of her hair.
I guess I'm not. I was on a bus with a group of them on the weekend. God, they were horrible. All drunk.
She laughs, remembering the lads with shaved heads and dumb laughs, the pitchy screams of the drunk girls with crap-faked tans. She had felt mortified on their behalf. It was like she was back in England. You know what I heard one of them say? This girl, prettiest girl you'd ever seen, she screams,
I was so shocked I could feel my stomach falling out my arsehole.
I mean, bloody hell. Way to give the English a bad name.
You call people like that chavs, right?
Eric asks. Joe stiffens. I hate it when people use that word.
Chavs?
It's classist. Eric pulls his arm away.
I don't know, he says. It's like saying bogans here.
Well, that's classist too.
You can have rich bogans.
Yeah, but the fact that you have to qualify it with rich says it all. Like they've got new money, but they're still low class. Eric shakes his head. You don't get it. He likes to say that. They've been together 8 months now, and she's getting to know all his habits, the little tells that let her know when he's irritated, upset, nervous. She's about to reply when her stomach buckles. She takes a breath, has a sip of soda water, feels the bubbles shimmer down her throat.
Where are you from in England anyway? Alice asks. For some reason, I always just think everyone from England is from London.
I was born in St. Ives, actually. It's kind of an English coastal holiday town. Then I went to live with my dad in Chesterfield when I was 7, which is in the East Midlands. She laughs. And definitely not a tourist town. She hopes they won't ask why she went to live with her dad. She's feeling too sick to lie well.
But you did live in London, Eric interjects before anyone gets the chance.
He likes to tell people she's a painter, rather than the truth, which is that she is a failed painter, an art school dropout. She hasn't picked up a brush in over a year, and she's glad of it.
Yeah, I studied in London for a bit before I moved here. Anyway, next round is starting in 5.
Are we losing? Ashwan asks, looking over Brianna's shoulder at their sheet. She stands, grabs her glass. It's the fun of playing that counts, right? With the microphone in her hand, Jo finds it easy to control the room. She's halfway through the last round. Everyone's heads are bent over their papers, whispering answers at one another. She's done the music round, and everyone sang along to everything from Blink-182 to Marilyn Monroe. She loves that she has this power to unify not only teams, but to bring a whole room of strangers together, create a feeling of joy from their shared experiences. Now it's the general knowledge round. The Southern Hemisphere is A, 10% land and 90% ocean, B, 20% land and 80% ocean, C, 30% land and 70% ocean, or D, 40% land and 60% ocean. Over at Jane's Got the Number, she can hear them hissing at each other.
I have no idea, do you know? It's a stupid question.
I think it's 20. It's the woman speaking, the one with the bright lipstick who had seemed on the outer earlier.
Are you sure? I don't know if trivia is your strong suit, to be honest.
I swear I read it somewhere, she says. Maybe I'm wrong.
The woman sits back, looks away. Joe catches her eye and says into the microphone, "Trust your instincts," then smiles. The woman sits up again.
"It's 20, I'm sure." The glaze
has gone. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.